categorized in four topics, different types of SAR system. The second topic is imaging platforms and wavelengths used in the SAR remote sensing, the mode of acquisition, and the SAR data format. So mainly these four topics will be covered in the lecture. Now, when we are talking about SAR systems, so SAR systems are mainly categorized in three categories: monostatic SAR systems, bistatic SAR systems, and multistatic SAR system. When we are talking about monostatic SAR systems, so from the name it is clear that single antenna will be used to transmit the electromagnetic pulses or the electromagnetic waves, and the same antenna will be used to receive the scattered electromagnetic signals. Now, in the case of monostatic system, it means that there will be only one antenna, and the same antenna will be working as transmitter and a receiver. Generally, when we are talking about the space-borne SAR remote sensing, so all the space-borne SAR systems are monostatic SAR systems. When we are talking about the another category, that is the bistatic radar system or bistatic synthetic aperture radar system. So from the name, again, it is clear in bistatic, there will be one transmitter and one receiver. Here, in this case, in the case of bistatic systems, transmitter and receiver both will be placed by a distance at separate location, and transmitter will be transmitting the electromagnetic pulses, and the receiver, which is placed at some distance from the receiver, is going to receive the electromagnetic signal after scattering from the Earth object. Now, generally, when we are talking about the space-borne SAR system, so due to the limitation of space and power consumption, generally only one antenna is used, so that the systems are known as the monostatic SAR systems. But there is one special case, like when the TerraSAR X and Tandem X, these two are the satellites, twin satellites launched by German Space Agency. When these satellites are operated in same orbit by maintaining a baseline or by maintaining a distance of 250 meter to 500 meter, so if both will be operated in the same orbit at the same time, so it is possible to do bistatic imaging. In that case, one will be transmitting the electromagnetic pulses and another satellite is going to work as receiver. Like suppose TerraSAR X is going to transmit the electromagnetic pulses, so at that time TerraSAR X
will now be recorded. This conference is no longer being recorded.
The satellite launched by the German Space Agency, that is the TerraSAR X add-on for the digital elevation measurement. So in that case, the another satellite, Tandem X, is going to receive the scattered electromagnetic waves, which was transmitted by the TerraSAR X. So in this case, the receiving mode of TerraSAR X, it might be possible that TerraSAR X is not going to receive any electromagnetic pulses because it is going to transmit only, and the transmission mode of Tandem X will be completely closed, so that only receiving mode will be on to receive the scattered electromagnetic waves. Like this is an example. Here we can see that TerraSAR X and Tandem X both are twin satellites. One is transmitting the electromagnetic pulses and the another is receiving the electromagnetic pulses after scattering from the Earth object. Like there are some other specific cases, like if anyone is interested to acquire the two data sets at one time, so at that time one will be transmitting the electromagnetic pulses and both the satellites are going to receive it, so that for one area at the same time there will be two images acquired by these two sensors. Now, before launch of TerraSAR X, German scientists, they did several type of experiments. So this was one experiment known as the hybrid configuration in bistatic SAR mode. So here, Terra SAR X was operated in spotlight mode to transmit the electromagnetic pulses for a specific location. And another sensor, which was working as a receiver, was placed on the aircraft, and aircraft was operated in strip map mode to receive all the signals which was transmitted in spotlight mode. After scattering, it was returned towards the receiver so that the receiver was able to capture the information which was transmitted in spotlight mode by Terra SAR X. So finally, images were generated. Now, in this experiment, it was found that very high resolution images were generated. Now here we can see the individual targets like buildings and the vegetation could be easily identified. Like here we are able to see the individual trees and their shadow also. So with the help of this bistatic SAR imaging, one will be able to get very high spatial resolution data set. Now another mode, the third mode, is a multi-static. So currently we do not have any SAR sensor in multi-static imaging mode. In multi-static imaging mode, again, this is categorized in two subcategory, and these categories are semi-active multi-static radar system and fully active multi-static radar system. So in semi-active multi-static radar system, there will be one transmitter and more than one receiver. And in the case of fully active multi-static radar system, there will be more than one transmitter and more than one receiver. Like in the case of semi-active, we can see the satellite is transmitting, and the transmission of electromagnetic pulses towards the object or Earth surface is represented by this red arrow. And after scattering from the Earth object, more than one sensors are there to receive the electromagnetic pulses. So this is the category coming under the semi-active multi-static radar system. And in the case of fully active multi-static radar system, there will be more than one transmitter. Here we can see that red arrow is representing the transmission of electromagnetic pulses. So like here in this case, there are three transmitters and three receivers. But currently this is under this satellite configuration, or the sensor configuration is under research, because currently we do not have any operational multi-static SAR system. Now when we are talking about the imaging platform, and so either sensor is monostatic or multi-static, so there is a requirement of imaging platforms to keep the SAR sensors. So there are three category, or there are three types of platforms. One is ground-based SAR sensor, another is airborne, and the third one is space-borne. And it is possible to do remote sensing with the help of all the types of platforms, like ground-based, airborne, and space-borne. So we are going to deal one by one all the types of platforms by seeing at least one to two examples of each and every type of platforms. So first of all, we are going to see the example of the ground-based SAR sensor. So here, this is the ground-based SAR sensor, and this is named as GBSAR also. Now, with the help of ground-based SAR system, it is easy to generate very high spatial resolution data set. Like this is one example of fast ground-based synthetic aperture radar. It is written fast GBSAR. So with the help of fast GBSAR, one will be able to generate very high spatial resolution. Here in this case, 0.5 to 0.75 meter spatial resolution could be generated. And it is possible to find out the land subsidence information, or landslide information, or any surface movement information
at the scale
of millimeter with the help of these SAR sensors. And with the help of ground-based synthetic aperture radar system, it is possible to do the imaging for any area if it is accessible or even it is inaccessible. So by placing the ground-based synthetic aperture radar system at a distance, one will be able to do the imaging with high spatial resolution. And there is no restriction of time, because in the case of space-borne and airborne SAR systems, we have time restriction. We can get the data set according to the satellite pass or according to the plan of the airborne sensors. But here in the case of GBSAR, one can simply carry this GBSAR to the field and they can do the imaging and they can do their experiment work, research work, or operational project work. And here, synthetic aperture radar, when we are talking about the concept of synthetic aperture radar, so SAR can be mounted on anything that is moving, because when the system will be or when the sensor will not be moving, so it will not be possible to generate high resolution images from the radar data set. Now the second example is airborne SAR remote sensing. So in the case of airborne platforms, generally aircrafts are used to carry the synthetic aperture radar sensors. So here there is a list of airborne sensors, like if you will see, this is ASR. In the background, the image is given, that is the image of ASR of NASA JPL. And similarly, there are other sensors like UAVSAR, ESAR, EMISAR, maintained by the different space agencies, and all the sensors are having different type of capabilities according to their nature of the data set, like their acquisition in the different polarimetric combination, as well as to operate them in the different frequency ranges. Like in the case of ASR could be operated in P, L, and C band. And in the case of AUSAR, if you will see, this could be operated only in X band. So it depends on the sensor capability, the sensor which could be mounted on the aircraft. Now, the next example we are going to see, the airborne sensor of ISRO, that is L and S band airborne SAR. So recently, the data sets were acquired for different locations in India. So this aircraft could be operated with the help of L and S band SAR sensors, and it can provide the data set in strip map mode. Like in the next few slides, we are going to see the different imaging modes of the SAR sensor. So this is one mode, strip map mode. So this sensor could be operated on strip map mode, and the sensor which is mounted, L and S band sensor which is mounted on the aircraft, could be operated between 24 degree to 77 degree angle of incidence, and it is possible to acquire the different polarization modes of the data set, like single polarization, dual polarization, fully polarimetric data set, as well as compact or the hybrid polarimetric SAR data set. And according to the guidebook, the maximum resolution which is possible with this sensor is 2x2, means 2 meter in azimuth resolution and 2 meter in slant range resolution. And the frequency on which the sensors are operated are 1.25 gigahertz, that is L band, and 3.20 gigahertz, that is S band. And when you will convert this frequency to the wavelength, so for L band, it will be coming 23.98 centimeter. And for S band, it will be coming to 9.36 centimeter. So the sensor could be operated on dual frequency, L band and S band. Now the third category is space-borne SAR systems. So this is a list of space-borne SAR systems. So here, if you will see, RISAT-1 is given. The RISAT-1 was launched in April 2012, and it could provide the data set in C-band, RADARSAT-1 and RADARSAT-2 were also launched in C-band, and the series of European Space Agency's SAR sensor of European Space Agency. Here we can get ERS-1, ERS-2, INVISAT, and Sentinel-1. Sentinel-1 is not written here. Sentinel-1A and 1B, both are also the twin satellites launched by European Space Agency. European Space Agency, and this is providing the data set in C-band. Now, JERS and LOS is the series of Japanese Space Research Center, JAXA, and it is providing the data set in L-band, TerraSAR-X and TandemX. TerraSAR-X was launched in 2007, TandemX was launched in 2010. These are the twin satellites, and these are capable to provide the quad-pole data set in X-band. Now, this is the different bands used in remote sensing. So when we are talking about space-bound SAR remote sensing, so currently we do not have any imaging SAR sensor in K-band, because particularly in K-band, wavelength is very, very small. When you will see 0.75 to 2.4 centimeter. So when the data set will be acquired, so it might be possible that there will be noise and hindrance due to the atmospheric cloud particles. So that most of the sensors, they are operated beyond 2.4 centimeter. Like in the case of X band, we have already seen TerraSAR-X and TandemX were there. So TerraSAR-X and TandemX were operated on 3 centimeter, mean wavelength is 3 centimeter, and the total wavelength range is 2.4 to 3.8 centimeter. Now here we have already seen in the previous slide, there are several satellites and sensors available in C-band, like ERS, INVISAT, RADARSAT, RISAT. So there are several sensors and satellites available in C-band. So generally, a mean wavelength which is used is in between 5.4 to 5.6 centimeter, but the total wavelength range for C-band is 3.8 to 7.5 centimeter. Now, currently, we do not have a space-bound SAR sensor in S-band, but NASA and ISRO, they both have the plan under NISAR mission to launch a sensor in S-band also. In L-band, again, we have seen like JERS and LOS-1 and LOS-2 all are operated on L-band only. The total wavelength range is 15 to 30 centimeter. Now, in the case of P-band, the wavelength range is 30 to 100 centimeter. This is very long wavelength range. Currently, we do not have any SAR sensor in P-band, because here we can see there will be increase in wavelength, like in the case of P-band, the wavelength is very, very long. Approximate wavelength will be in between 60 to 70 centimeter. Now, in the previous class, we have explored that when the wavelength will be long, there will be high penetration in the soil and even high penetration in the canopy cover. So European Space Agency has a plan to launch one satellite in P-band, and they have given the name biomass, because since the wavelength is approximately 70 centimeter, so it will be able to penetrate through the dense canopy cover of tropical forest also. So after penetrating the canopy cover, it will be able to provide the information of stable structure, like structure of forest vegetation or stem and the big branches. So that information could be retrieved. So it will become easy to do forest mapping and monitoring, so that the name is given biomass. Now, we have seen the different SAR systems and different platforms used to do the SAR imaging. Now, here we are going to focus on the mode of acquisition of the SAR data. So there are three modes to acquire the SAR data set. One is scan SAR mode, another is STIP map mode, And the third one is spotlight mode. Now again, spotlight mode is again categorized in two category, sliding spotlight and steering spotlight. But this capacity is available only with TerraSAR X. Generally, all the other satellites, they are providing only one spotlight mode of the SAR sensor, but TerraSAR X has the capability to acquire the data set in two different spotlight modes, sliding and steering spotlight mode. In sliding spotlight mode, the data set will be provided approximately with 1 meter resolution, but in steering spotlight mode, the TerraSAR X will be able to provide the data set with 25 centimeter resolution also. And now the fourth category, which is written here, that is the interferometric mode. So ScanSAR mode, steep map mode, and spotlight mode all may be operated in interferometric mode also. Simply interferometric mode is a special mode in which the two data sets will be acquired in same SAR geometry. Now we are going to discuss one by one the different modes of the SAR image acquisition. Now here, if you will see, this is image is representing the RISAT one mode of operation. So RISAT one has the capability to provide the data set in different modes, like MRS mode, CRS mode, HRS mode, and the FRS mode. Now we are going to see the different modes of the RISAT one. So MRS mode is representing the medium resolution ScanSAR mode. FRS mode is representing fine resolution strip map mode. CRS is representing the coarse resolution ScanSAR mode. And HRS is representing high resolution spotlight mode. So currently we do not have any operational high resolution spotlight mode data set provided by RISAT-1, but all the other modes of the data set are available. And one advantage or one property of RISAT-1 could be easily seen here, like RISAT-1 was capable to provide the two different types of ScanSAR mode, like MRS and CRS, medium resolution ScanSAR and the coarser resolution ScanSAR. Okay, and there are the different swaths according to the resolution, because when the resolution will be high, so swaths will be automatically less. In the case of FRS1 and FRS2, the swath was 25 kilometer, and the sensor was able to provide the data set in single, dual, and circular polarization in FRS1 mode, and quad and circular in FRS2 mode. And for MRS and CRS, the swaths are 115 and 233 kilometer respectively. And it was possible to acquire the data set in single, dual, and the circular polarimetric mode. And here in the third row, you can easily see there is decrease in resolution when there is increase in the swath. So in high resolution, the resolution was kept 1 meter by 1 meter. And in FRS1 mode, the resolution was 3 by 2. And in FRS2, this is 9 and 4. In the case of MRS and CRS, we are getting moderate resolution as well as the coarser resolutions are it. Now, one may think about what is ScanSAR. Actually, in ScanSAR mode, SAR sensor is not operated for one fixed area or fixed location. Using beam steering capability, here we can see, using beam steering capability, sensor will be operated with a range of angle of incidence or the look angles. Okay, so that if it will be operated with different ranges of incidence angle, so finally a very large area will be covered. And this mode is also known as the burst mode or the wide swath mode. And to achieve a wide swath, the sensor is periodically switching the antenna according to different look angles. And when the look angles will be changed, so accordingly, it will be possible to cover a very large area. Like here in this case, you can see the like in the case of near range, this is one can think about the near range. So near range here, the angle of incidence will be low, but when the sensor is immediately operated on any other angle of incidence, suppose here it is 25 degree, and again it is operated at 28 degree and 30 degree. So by changing, by switching the angle of incidence, one will be able to get very large swath. But since the sensor is operated for one area with very less time, so that to cover a very large area, but due to this limitation, there will be less resolution which could be obtained from the SAR sensor. Why? Because as in the case of azimuth resolution, we have already seen, like, to increase the azimuth resolution, SAR sensor was operated for one specific target for a larger time period. But here the sensor will not be operated for a larger or longer time period, so that the spatial resolution will become very, very less. Now this is an example of wide swath mode of the TerraSAR X image. So here we can see that the swath is approximately a very large 270 kilometer by 200 kilometer. But again, here spatial resolution is approximately 40 meter. But if anyone is interested to work for a larger area, suppose for flood mapping and monitoring, or for land use and land cover mapping, so at that time people are in need of such a data set which will be having very large coverage. So at that time, this wide swath mode data sets are going to help them in their project works. But and there are several other modes, so we are going to discuss those modes also. This is one special mode of MRS mode of RISAT-1. So here the data set was acquired by RISAT-1 in HH polarization mode. And here you can see the linear feature, the dark linear feature is basically a river, the river Ganga, and this could be easily seen as a dark feature, because as we all are knowing that water is going to work as perfectly smooth surface. So the amount of electromagnetic wave which will be transmitted by the SAR sensor will be reflected away from the direction of the sensor by the water body, so that SAR sensor is not going to capture any information or any scattering information of this water body. So finally, the objects which is not going to give any scattering towards the sensor is going to appear as a dark feature. So here linear feature will be appearing as dark feature. And this is the river Ganga, and another linear channel we are getting, another water body. This is the river Yamuna, and one small river channel could also be detected easily. This is the Ken River, and if you are able to see these bright patches in the imagery, so these are the cities, urban cities of like this place is Fatehpur city in UP, and this is Rai Bareli, and this is Bandar city in UP. So in one imagery, in one image, one will be able to find information of different type of land use and land cover, and it will be very easy to do the mapping with the help of the wide swath images of the SAR data set. Now another mode is steep map mode. So in steep map mode, SAR sensor is not going to use the beam steering capability. The sensor will be fixed at a particular look angle. So in this case, sensor is fixed, and it will be fixed with that particular angle of incidence for the entire acquisition of the SAR data. Like here in this case, the SAR sensor is fixed towards the earth surface, and suppose this is the first time when the acquisition was started, and this is the last point. After that, sensor will not be operated, so that the sensor is going to acquire one strip of the Earth surface, and that surface will be imaged by the sensor, and finally image will be generated. Now, in the case of steep map mode, we are generally going to get the moderate resolution, not very high spatial resolution, not the coarser resolution. So steep map modes data sets are widely used for different applications like forest parameter retrieval, glaciological application. There are several other applications. But one advantage what we are going to get, generally quad pole data sets, like all the satellites, they are providing the fully polarimetric SAR data set or the quad pole data set in steep map mode only. Because when the sensor will be operated to acquire all the four polarimetric combinations of the SAR data set, then it will not be possible to maintain very large swath. And with the help of four polarimetric channels, it will not be possible to acquire the data set with very high spatial resolution. So that we are getting a relatively moderate resolution when we are comparing with spotlight and scan SAR mode. So relatively we are going to get the moderate resolution. But when we are talking about, or whenever we are going to order the fully polarimetric SAR data set or quad pole data set, then those data sets are acquired only in steep map mode. Okay. Now, this is the RI set one fine resolution steep map mode. And the polarization channel is RH. RH is representing the transmission of right circularly electromagnetic wave. And H is representing the receiving of linearly polarization, particularly in the horizontal vibration. So in this case, so that the name is given hybrid polarimetry. Hybrid means circularly polarized electromagnetic waves were transmitted and linearly polarized electromagnetic waves were received. So here right circular electromagnetic waves were transmitted and horizontally polarized linear polarization were received, so that the name is given RH. Now, the resolution of this imagery is approximately 13.32 meter in along track. It means that in azimuth direction and in the range direction, the resolution is 4.6 meter. Now, if you will see this image, one area is acquired and the total swath is 25 kilometer by 25 kilometer. We are able to find the different type of features available within the scene, like this river body could be easily identified as a dark linear object, linear feature in the imagery. This is the Banganga River in Rajasthan. And this linear track, this bright linear track or bright linear feature could also be seen here. And this is basically a rail line, because if there will be a road, and if the trees will not be appearing on the both sides of the road, so road is going to appear as a dark linear feature. But here the linear feature is appearing bright. It means that there are some objects which are going to contribute in scattering. And generally on the railway tracks, what we are getting, we are going to get a small size of stones, and the linear combination of two tracks of rail lines, or two rail lines could be easily seen. So this structure is small stone size, and the railway track is going to contribute in scattering, and finally high scattering will be obtained by the SAR sensor, so that this linear railway track is appearing as a bright object. And one city, this is Bandiqui city in Rajasthan. So this city could be seen here as a bright patch here, and undulating terrain and the hilly terrain could be easily seen from the SAR data set. Now this is the spotlight mode for Norway, one of the city in Norway. And the data set was acquired by the TerraSAR X in normal spotlight mode. In normal spotlight mode or sliding spotlight mode, the data set will have approximately of 1 meter resolution. Now another mode, another subcategory of spotlight mode is the steering spotlight mode. So in steering spotlight mode, the sensor will be focused toward the center of the scene to identify one small object, so that the total swath will become less and resolution will become very, very high. The steering spotlight mode is a classical spotlight mode with azimuth antenna steering to a rotation center inside the image scene. The antenna beam is steered to scene center during the complete data take. Now here you can see, with the help of steering spotlight mode, now if you will compare with the previous image, we can easily get the enhancement in the resolution. Here, resolution is now 25 centimeter, but the swath is very less, 4 kilometer by 3.7 kilometer only. Resolution is very high, but swath is very, very less. Now we are going to see the interferometric mode. So in interferometric mode, SAR sensor should be operated in such a mode so that the two data sets for one area could be obtained. Like here, A1 and A2 are representing the image acquisition by the sensor at one time, and the A2 is representing the image acquisition at the second time by the second sensor or by the same sensor. Like in the case of space-borne SAR sensors, we have seen that all the space-borne SAR sensors are monostatic SAR sensor. So in the case of monostatic SAR sensor, there is a requirement of repeat passage to acquire the data set for the same area. Like in the case of radar set 2, the repeat pass is defined for 24 days. Suppose one data set is acquired for 1 day, so the next interferometric pair or the next data set in interferometric mode will be acquired only after 24 days. Similarly, in the case of LOS, the repeat pass is defined 46 days, and TerraSARx for each and every satellite and sensor, the repeat passage have been defined, and the satellite will provide the data set on the limitation or according to the temporal gap of the repeat pass. Now, in the case of interferometry, to generate the interferogram, one should order the data set in the same SAR geometry configuration. Now, when you ask to space agencies to acquire the interferometric acquisition of the SAR data set for any specific area, then during both the time periods or during both the acquisition, the sensors will be operated in same mode with same geometric configuration. Same mode, we have seen that there are three modes: scan SAR mode, strip map mode, and spotlight mode. So suppose in the first acquisition, the sensor was operated in spotlight mode with 25 degree angle of incidence. So in the second acquisition, again the sensor will be operated in spotlight mode with 25 degree angle of incidence. There should not be any change, because if there will be any change in the either imaging mode or in the angle, so interferometry could not be done. So to get the interferometric data sets, the satellite should be operated in same imaging mode with the same SAR geometric configuration. Now, generally, space-borne SAR sensors are monostatic, so we are getting the data set after the repeat passage, or according to the defined repeat passage, defined temporal gap of the SAR sensor. But when the TerraSARx and TandemX both will be maintained in the same orbit, so it will be possible to get the two data sets at the same time. Like here in this case, one sensor, suppose TerraSARx is transmitting electromagnetic pulses, so the electromagnetic pulses will be transmitted towards the Earth surface, one area will be imaged, and after scattering from the Earth object, the energy which will be scattered towards the sensor. So at that time, the receiving mode will be on in both the satellites, TerraSARx and TandemX. So both will be generating images for the same area. So for the same area, we will have one interferometric data set or one interferometric pair with zero temporal gap. Because sometimes due to the temporal gap, there will be changes in the Earth's surface. So sometimes if the changes will be large, so again, like if the objects will not be recognized, so interferogram could not be generated, interferometric mapping will become difficult. But those limitations could be overcome with the help of biostatic SAR interferometry. Now we are going to see the different formats of the SAR data set. So there are different formats of the SAR data: raw data, SLC data, multi-loop data, geocoded data, and polarimetric data. In polarimetric data, again, we can see there are different types of polarimetric combination, like single polarimetric, dual polarimetric, quad pole, hybrid pole, and sometimes data sets are also provided in the Stokes format. Now, when we are talking about raw data, so raw data is the responses of electromagnetic signal which were received by the sensor from different objects on the Earth's surface. Now, in the raw data, the SAR signal energy is reflected from one signal point is spread along azimuth and the range direction. Because here we have seen that the SAR sensor will have the two directions, the azimuth direction in which SAR sensor is moving, azimuth direction, the flight direction, and the range direction in which SAR sensor is transmitting electromagnetic pulses. So here, what we have read, that is the information of one single target, one single point, is spread along azimuth as well as range direction. Here we can see this is one point target, response of one type of point target, and this response, this is the azimuth direction and this is the range direction. So when the scattering is occurred after interaction of electromagnetic wave with the target, so the signals were returned back towards the sensor, and it is not possible that the response from one target will be captured back by the sensor at same location, because sensor is moving in azimuth direction, transmitting electromagnetic pulses in range direction. So what will happen? The response of point target will be distributed along azimuth direction as well as along range direction. So in the raw data set, we will not be able to identify any object. Because this is not basically an image, this is simply the collection of responses of electromagnetic signal received by the sensor from different objects. Now, from the raw data set, there is requirement of focusing, like the data set which is spread in range direction, so compression will be done at the exact location of the object in azimuth direction and range direction after knowing the exact position of the data set. And finally, the product which will be generated after focusing the data set or after compressing the data set in azimuth and range direction, the product will be the single look complex SAR image or SLC image. SLC, single look complex SAR image. Why we are saying it as complex? Because each and every resolution cell or pixel resolution cell of the SAR data set will be represented by complex numbers, by at least two channels, a real channel and imaginary channel. Like in this case, this is the radar set 2 SLC image for San Francisco area, and this is the HH channel. Now for the sea surface, for this particular resolution cell, the values are 0.58 and minus 0.35. It means that the real channel value is 0.587 and imaginary channel is having the value minus 0.35. Why? Because the SAR image is basically a representation of the interaction of electromagnetic wave with the particular target. And it will have the information of the phase of electromagnetic wave at the time of interaction with the particular target. So to find out the phase and amplitude of the electromagnetic wave at the time of interaction with the particular target, the data set should be represented in the complex numbers. Okay, so here the data set is represented here in the terms of the complex number, so that one can easily find the phase of this resolution cell with the help of the formula tan inverse imaginary quantity divided by the real quantity, and one can easily find out the amplitude or intensity. Amplitude one can easily find out is square root of real channel square or square of the real channel plus square of the imaginary channel. So one can easily find out the amplitude as well as phase of the SAR data set. Okay, because in the absence of the channels, suppose if the data set is represented in the terms of intensity, so one will not be able to do polarimetry and interferometry, because at that time one will have to work only with the intensity image or the backscatter image only. So to do the polarimetry and interferometry, the data set should have the complex number information, or the SAR data set should be represented by the complex number. So generally people are ordering the this label one data, that is the single look complex SAR data set, to do the polarimetry and the interferometry. Now here we can see this SAR data, SLC data. This is the complex image, and the complex image is divided in the two parts, real channel and imaginary channel. If you will try to see individually, there is some information in each channel, like real channel and imaginary channel, but you cannot easily identify the objects in one channel. But when you will merge both the channels, real channel and imaginary channel, so one can easily see the different type of features imaged by the sensor in the area. Now the there is another product, that is the multi-look data. Actually, in the multi-looking, first step is the slant to ground range conversion to minimize the ambiguity. Ambiguity due to the slant range acquisition by converting slant to the ground range, and after that multi-looking is performed to generate a square pixel shape. Like here in this case, one can see this is the radar set 2 image before multi-looking, and this is the radar set 2 image after multi-looking. Like one can generate the images according to their calculation, because either they can do the independent calculation, or nowadays softwares are also capable to find out the appropriate number of looks, so one can directly do the softwares. Like here in this case, multi-looking was performed by selecting the number of looks in azimuth direction as 5 and number of looks in range direction as 2. Now here one can see that there is enhancement in the radiometric progression. Since we are taking the several help of several pixels, several resolution cell to generate a square pixel, so that we are going to compromise with the spatial resolution, but there will be enhancement in the radiometric property of the SAR data set, so that visualization will become easy. Like this Golden Gate Bridge of San Francisco could be easily seen. The urban area could be easily seen here. This is the city, and the hilly terrain, undulating terrain, and their vegetation could be easily seen, and their values could be retrieved. Now another category, geocoded data set. Sometimes people are getting difficulty to do the georeferencing or to get the coordinate information from the SAR data set. So now the space agencies are giving the flexibility to directly order the geocoded data set also, but generally they are providing the intensity image in geocoded data set. Means when they are providing the multi-looked or geocoded, or the multi-looked geocoded data set, it means that the data set will be mainly in the intensity format. And when it will convert it to intensity or amplitude format, so it will be again not possible to do polarimetry and interferometry. But few sensors and few agencies are providing the multi-look data set in complex format also. That those data sets are MLC, multi-look complex format data sets. So those data sets are available, and if the people are interested, they can work with those data sets also. But those agencies are really very less, and only few sensors are available for which the data sets are provided in multi-look complex mode. Now, when we are coming to the polarimetric mode, so there are maximum four polarimetric channels, as we have seen that when the SAR sensor is operated in the linear polarization. So four polarimetric channels, HH, SV, VH, and VV are possible. HH is representing transmission of horizontally polarized electromagnetic wave, and another H is representing the receiving of the horizontally polarized electromagnetic wave. Similarly, in HV, HV is representing horizontally polarized electromagnetic wave was transmitted, and vertically polarized electromagnetic wave was received. Similarly for VH and VV. Now, in the case of single polarimetric data set, out of the four polarimetric channels, only one polarimetric combination will be provided, either HH or HV or VH or VV. In the case of dual polarimetric SAR data set, two polarimetric combinations out of these four polarimetric combinations, two polarimetric combinations will be provided. So the data set will be known as dual pole. When all the four polarimetric combinations will be provided, then the data set will be known as quad pole. Now, currently we have the RISET data set in hybrid polarimetric or compact polarimetric mode. So here circularly polarized electromagnetic waves were transmitted and the linearly polarized electromagnetic waves were received, so that the name is given hybrid. And another format is Stokes format. Now we are going to see the example of different types of data set in each and every polarimetric mode. Now this is the single polarimetric data set acquired by the TerraSAR-X in spotlight mode with VV polarization. Here we can see the polarization is VV, and the angle of incidence, this is the mean angle of incidence, this is 41.9 degree. Now when the data sets or when the SAR sensors are operated in spotlight mode, so generally they are operated with single polarization, because when the number of polarizations will be increased, so it will become very easy to get very large number of responses for responses of electromagnetic wave from one target, because the responses will be collected in all the four polarimetric mode. So that to minimize that ambiguity, only one polarimetric channel is used to acquire the data set in spotlight mode to create very high spatial resolution information. Now here we can see that the data set is really very high spatial resolution, because here if you will see, one can easily identify the individual ships also. If you will see these bright objects, these are the ships. One can easily identify the ships. When you will zoom in the data set, you can get the shape and the size information of these ships also. This is the dual polarimetric data set acquired by the RISET-1 in FRS-1 mode. So these modes are VV and VH. So this is the example of dual polarimetric data set. In dual polarimetric mode, one will have either HH plus HV combination or HH plus VV or VV plus VH combination. Because HV and VH both will have approximately similar type of information, so combination of HV and VH is not provided. All the other combinations like HH plus HV, HH plus VV, and VV plus VH are provided. And like here in this case, we have the third combination, VV plus VH. Here VV is representing transmission of vertical polarization, and the time of receiving vertically polarized were received. Now in the case of VH, vertically was transmitted, horizontally was received. So generally there is complete change in polarization received by the multiple scattering or multiple scatterers, and multiple scattering is generally obtained from the forest vegetation. Now here if you will see the information of the object which is enhanced in VH will be generally vegetation. If you compare both the imagery, so the vegetation information, like this is the forest area. So this forest area is showing very high scattering in comparison to the VV channel. Okay. So accordingly, people are doing interpretation. In the next classes, we will see how to retrieve the scattering contributed by the forest vegetation, scattering contributed by the urban area, scattering contributed by the surface scatters, by or by the barren land, or by the river. So those we are going to explore. Now, here in the case of VV channel, one can easily say this feature is appearing bright, but this feature is not appearing very much bright here. Okay, so bright means the very high scattering is obtained for this location, and there is very less scattering obtained for obtained in the VH channel. So it might be possible that there are different type of features, and their behavior is changing. Their scattering behavior is changing in different polarimetric combination. Now this is the quad pole data of radar set 2 image for San Francisco area. This data set is freely available. One can download and work. Like here you can see, this is the HH channel. First one is HH channel, the second is HV, then VV and VH. All the four polarimetric combinations were acquired by radar set 2 at the same time period. Okay, so now here you can see in HH, there is very high scattering from all the type of features like this sea surface. The sea surface is also showing some scattering, but the object which is showing some scattering is not showing any scattering information in the cross polarimetric channel HV, because here you can see that the sea surface is appearing as completely dark feature in the cross polarimetric channel HV and VH. Okay, and similarly we can see here there is very high scattering for urban area in HH and VV. Now, if you will see, for the forest vegetation, like these are the, this is the forest cover appearing in the undulating terrain, in the hilly terrain of the San Francisco area. So here what we are getting, the forest canopy or the forest vegetation is showing high scattering in HV and VH, and relatively scattering is less in VV and HH. Now, with the help of all the four polarimetric channels, one will be able to generate a scattering matrix. A scattering matrix is simply a 2x2 matrix. In the next classes, we will see several times this scattering matrix, because when we are talking about the polarimetry, so this scattering matrix is going to play a very important role, because with the help of this scattering matrix only, we are able to do polarimetry, and polarimetrics are interferometry. Now, with the help of all the four polarimetric channels, HH, HV, VH, and VV, we are going to create a 2x2 matrix, and the matrix which will be created from different polarimetric combinations of the SAR data set for the same area which was acquired at the same time period will be known as scattering matrix. Now, another type data set is hybrid polarimetric data set. So in hybrid polarimetric data set, like in the case of RI set 1, so RI set 1 circularly polarized FRS1 mode was operated on the two polarimetric channels RH and RV. RH is representing the transmission of right circular electromagnetic wave, and at the time of receiving, horizontally polarized electromagnetic waves were received. And similarly, in the case of RV, right circularly electromagnetic waves were transmitted and the vertically was received. It means that to generate this dual pole data set, at the time of transmission, only right circular polarization was transmitted, and at the time of receiving, horizontally and vertically polarized electromagnetic waves were received. Now, why the sensor was operated in hybrid polarimetric mode? Actually, first of all, when as we have already seen in the case of scan-SAR mode, the sensor was operated with only one polarization. Why? To cover a very large swath. It means that when the number of polarimetric channels will be increased, the swath is going to decrease. So in dual polarimetric channel, we can compromise with the swath. Why? Because there will be only one mode of transmission, means only one polarization will be transmitted, and at the time of receiving, the two different polarizations, horizontal and vertical, will be received, so that we can maintain a large swath, and onboard processing will become also less, because in the case of quad pole data set, the processing will have to be done for four polarimetric channels. Now here the processing could be done only for two channels. Or basically, this hybrid polarimetric data set is a special category of dual pole data only. Okay. Now here what happened? Right circularly was transmitted and horizontally vertical was received. Now one may ask, okay, like we are able to get the advantage in the terms of swath, but what will be the other advantages we can get from the data set? So here you can see the formula. Like when we will have the right circularly transmitted data and horizontally vertically received, so RH could be represented in the terms of HH and HV, and RV could be represented in the terms of VV and HV. It means that when we will have this hybrid pole data set, so one can make an effort to generate pseudo quad pole data to retrieve the benefit of quad pole property of the SAR data set from hybrid polarimetric SAR data only. Now this is the Stokes format of the SAR data set. So Stokes vectors, generally there are four Stokes vectors, S0, S1, S2, and S3. These are generated with the help of horizontal and the vertical polarimetric combination. So here one can see these polarimetric combinations could be easily generated. Now in the case of Chandrayaan 1 mini SAR, those data sets were provided in the Stokes file format. So here you can see the S0, S1, S2 and S3. S0 will have the maximum information, and S1, S2 and S3 will have the relatively less information. Less information means less intensity in comparison to the S0. These are the criteria for fully polarimetric and the partially polarimetric data. So we will be going in some detail in the next classes of the SAR polarimetry. Now I just want to show the future mission. This is the NISAR mission, and it will be launched in 2021, then expected to be launched in 2021. So in NISAR mission, the dual frequency SAR data set will be used, L-band and S-band. L-band will have 24 centimeter wavelength, S-band will have the 12 centimeter wavelength, and sweep SAR technique will be used to generate very large swath, and the satellite will be able to provide the data set in single, dual and quad pole, and it will have the 12 days repeat pass to provide the interferometric mode, to provide the interferometric data set. It means that one will be able to get the interferometric SAR data set at the time interval of 12 days. Here one can see the different other parameters, and I have given the link of the user handbook of this NISAR mission. So they have already provided the detailed information in this handbook regarding this mission, the data type and the other property, and even several modeling approaches which could be used to find out the biophysical, geophysical and other parameters. One can go through that handbook to find the detailed information of this NISAR mission. Thank you.